Tonight, I've been invited to speak about the first book that I wrote, 1994, 21 years ago now, and how that book came about. It eventually led me to do the thesis on Meyer's work and spirit possession, but I want to go back and talk about its origins and my relationship with Lao Tzu. So I'm going to tell you a story, and this is the first opportunity I've had of talking to a group of people that I feel will be receptive to what I'm saying, rather than my other experiences of talking to a group of university students who are being taught in the university according to a particular discipline, and they have to conform to that discipline. So I don't have to do that here. We've all got free mind, right? We're free thinkers. So now I can say what I like, right? And I know I'm not going to be academically challenged for it, which I have been in the past. So I want to take you back to the origins of the book. When I wrote it, I was uneducated. Before I went to university, I'd been a truck driver, I'd been a transport manager. I was a conference and exhibition organizer in the distribution industry. And that's all I knew about. I was spiritually and academically uneducated, okay? And then at the end of Thatcherism, when the economy crashed, my business went with it. My exhibition and conference business that had taken me 8 years to build up was suddenly no more. All my assets were gone, and I found myself living on the island of Crete in a cave as a hermit. Saying to the universe, what am I doing here? Now what do we do? Everything had gone. Everything I'd learned was of no use to me, and I had to start all over again. And that's when I began to learn. And my time spent in Crete, I had a series of mystical experiences, and that's why when I came back, I had to study eventually mysticism as an academic subject, because I needed to understand what had been happening to me. I discovered, it seemed to me at the time as if by chance, that I had the gift of hands-on healing, which I had no experience of, no knowledge of at all. And I treated a woman who'd been suffering from a bad back for 8 years, and her husband came to me, because I'd been helping people with headaches and insect bites and ingrowing fingernails and things that caused them pain. So people started talking about this strange Englishman that lived up in the mountain. And I was literally dragged by the arm to this man's house, this Greek man, whose wife was back. She'd had it for 8 years. And he loved his wife. She was a beautiful woman, and it wasn't just an excuse because she didn't want his advances. They were genuinely in love with each other, and it was a big problem. I couldn't speak Greek, and they couldn't speak English, so I just motioned for this woman to sit in a chair on the street outside their house. Sat in a chair, and I stood behind her, put my hands behind her. And in a very short space of time, I suppose it must have been about 30 seconds, she looked up at me with a big smile on her face, and I motioned for her to stand up and bend over, and she can probably touch her toes better than I can now, because age shows, is beginning to show. She touched her toes, and her husband looked at me and he went, "What kind of magic is this?" the answers. And then I began to get a name repeating in my mind, the name of James. And with that, I had a compulsion, and I went to my little campsite up in the mountains and rummaged around in my pack for a gift that had been given to me by a very dear friend. And I had never appreciated the value of this gift before. It was a copy of the King James Bible. This was a German friend of mine. And it was well thumbed, and there was all sorts of markings in it. She hadn't just read this Bible, she'd studied it. And she gave it to me as a gift, and I didn't really appreciate the value of it until I had a compulsion to rummage around in my pack, and it came out and it fell open at the Book of James, and I read it. And I was stunned. I knew it was important, but I didn't realise how important it was. And it said, if you seek wisdom, ask God and you'll get it. Basically is what it said. And I said to Lewis just earlier this evening, every single question I've asked, I've been given the answer. And that's where my story begins. Now, there I was, living in absolute paradise. I had no job, no wife, no home, no income, no problem. It was idyllic. It was wonderful. People used to come to me with their problems, and I'd just sit and listen, and they'd go, oh, thank you very much. And beekeepers, all sorts of people. And I said to a beekeeper one day, I was sat quietly having a cup of coffee by the seaside, and this chap from a local village came and sat beside me. I'm getting to know his name. He came and said, can I sit with you? I said, yeah. And the scene, his name was. Yeah, sure, sit down. Sat there quietly having a cup of coffee, and he started telling me all his problems. I said, Vasily, why are you telling me this? He said, because you're everybody's father. I said, is that what they say about me? And he said, yeah. I had no income, had nothing. So this whole situation was alien to me, because I'd come from the ethos of working in this country and struggling and conforming and paying the taxes and the VAT and employing people and everything that goes with it. And there I am suddenly in paradise with respect. So it was like being on another planet. It was wonderful. I was in paradise. It was amazing. But then, peaks and troughs, ups and downs. While I was in this situation, and this was the story I wanted to tell you about happiness, there I was, my little campsite, there was a cave and a fig tree and a little stream, it was perfect. And this couple, this English couple, were visiting Crete on holiday. And they stumbled across my little enchanted paradise. And I was sat there brewing a cup of coffee. And they stumbled across me and went, oh, sorry. And straight away they felt that they were intruding. And I said, well, that's okay, come on. Come and sit down and have a cup of coffee. I've just put a kettle on. So they pulled up a log and sat down. And they looked at me and they said, wow, this is fantastic. And the husband said to the wife, he said, do you know what he said? This must be the happiest man I've ever seen. Aren't you lucky? And I said, yes, I am. But I'd like to make the distinction between happiness and contentment. I said, I wouldn't describe myself as happy. I'm content with the way things are. And that was when I first began to think about the difference, about the meaning of happiness. Was on that occasion. And funny enough, a few weeks later, I got a letter in the taverna of the village close by. The owner of the taverna, and I went in there one day and he called me over. They used to call me Pedro because the Greeks can't say Terry. Pedro. Letter from England. Well, who's writing to me? And I've looked at the address and it's called Man in a Tent. Asagiri Street. And it got to me. And they were saying how they were thanking me for my hospitality. I still got it somewhere. Anyway, so that was the situation I was in. Uneducated, disillusioned from living in this country and trying to conform in this country, and finding myself living in paradise with the gift of healing, and everything was wonderful. But then everything changed. People came with serious problems that I couldn't help them with. Alcoholics came. They stumbled across this place I was living. Oh, wonderful. Yeah, crack another one. Let's all sit around the campfire and sing songs and get pissed. And they ruined everything. And there was nothing I could do. So I took an interest in alcoholism. I needed to understand it. In fact, one time in my house, years later, I did learn to understand it, and I had three alcoholics living in my house in England. I got to the bottom of it. But it was a painful process getting there, because these people destroyed everything that I was experiencing. And I had to leave. I had to come home to England, to nothing, and leave all that behind me. And that was when I that was when I asked this question. Why? Why take me to this place, show me these things, give me these gifts, and then pull the rug away and come back to nothing? Why? And the book is the result. Because when I, going back to what I was saying about in the book of James, if you want wisdom, you can ask God. I was just crying out in the night, why? God's sake, why? You know, not aiming the question at anyone or anything in particular. And then I got another compulsion. It was different from the one in Crete, where I had a compulsion to go and rummage and get the book out of the rucksack. This was a bigger compulsion. This was a compulsion to write. And for 3 months, I sat at a word processor, thumping in, writing. And as I'm writing it, I'm standing back and I'm reading it. And I'm thinking, where's this coming from? And I'd virtually finished it. How many chapters have you got? 19 chapters, isn't it? I got almost to the end. And so I'd come back from Crete, disillusioned and in despair of being brought back from paradise, in search for answers. So I decided to follow three avenues to get the knowledge I needed to understand these experiences in Crete. And the three avenues I followed, one was to go to university and get a degree in psychology, because I needed to understand what made some people, so destructive. I needed to know the answer to that question. And I thought psychology would give me the answer to that. So I enrolled to do a degree in psychology. The second avenue was spiritualism. Because of my experiences in Crete, I needed to understand this healing power. I knew nothing about it. So I started to go to my local spiritualist church in Folkestone at the time. And the other avenue I followed was to learn formally about hypnosis, because like the woman with the bad back, there were many occasions when I'd just come and stand behind a person, put my hand behind the back of their neck, and they'd go into trance, and I hadn't said a word. So I needed to know what was happening here. So I went to study hypnosis. And I didn't learn the answer to that question there either. The answer to that question came much later when I was doing the research for the book, The Science of Spirit Possession. What I'd learned was that hands-on healing, in Japan they call it Reiki, given all sorts of names. But it was first called, in academic or scientific circles, it was first called animal magnetism by Franz Mesmer, who's regarded as being the forerunner, the precursor to hypnosis. So there was a link there, this healing energy and going into trance. I needed to understand it. So I followed those three avenues, hypnosis, spiritualism, and psychology, academic psychology. So these three avenues, eventually, over the course of 20 years, they came together. It took 20 years for me to bring them together, and that's where the second book got published, Science of Spirit Possession, brings those three avenues together. But going back to the original book, where I needed these answers, I'd enrolled for you to go to university, so I was completely uneducated. I'd begun to learn about hypnosis and I'd begun to go to the spiritualist church, and there was a young man I met at the spiritualist church who asked me to help him because he was suffering from low self-esteem and lack of self-confidence, and he needed to learn how to build his confidence. So he asked me if I could use hypnosis to help him. So I said, fine. I'd been compelled to write this book, which I called at the time The Silent Witness, because unfortunately BBC came along later and called their friends. So I had to drop that name, but that was the name that first occurred to me, simply because I was naive and uneducated, knew nothing, so I had nothing to say. So I had to be silent. And the only way I could learn was from observing and listening. And that's why it was called The Silent Witness. I was the witness that was just learning. And this text was evolving. So I'd enrolled to go to on an access course, because I had no qualified, no GCSEs or anything like that. So I had to go on an access course to do the A-level equivalent, just to demonstrate that I had the intelligence to go to university. And while I was doing that, this young man came to me for hypnosis. And we'd done some work, and he was just coming out of his trance. I'm going to sit down for this, because I'm going to demonstrate to you what he was like. He's a young man, he's a big man. And he was a beautiful subject for trance work, for hypnosis work. And he went into deep trance. And we'd do the work, and then he'd come out of it, and I'd bring him back. Sit up and look at me, open his eyes and look at me. And he'd come out of his trance on this one day and he said, can I say something? I said, what is it? And he said, I just had a really strange experience. He said, I felt that somebody wanted to talk to you, but it wasn't me. I said, that's interesting. I said, should we investigate? Should we find out what this is about? And he said, fine. Yeah. So I said, okay, go back into trance for me. And he went back into trance. And he went deep. I thought he was going to fall off the chair. He went. And I just let him be. And I said, who wants to talk to me? And his buddy came up, right? And he opened his eyes and he looked at me. And I could see straight away that it was not him. It was the same body and the same face. But the look in the eyes, the whole demeanour, his whole countenance was different. And I said, who are you? And he introduced himself as Jan P. And explained that he was a 14th century Chinese scholar. And he was interested in those things that interested me. And we began to discuss what I was writing in the book. And he helped me, he guided me. And this went on for a couple of weeks. This young man would come round to my house, and we'd sit there, and he'd go into trance, and I would talk to Chan Ping and make notes while he was completely out of it. And I asked him to explain to me what it was like. He said, well, he said, it's a bit like being at the other end of a long corridor. You can hear voices at the other end of the corridor, but you can't make out what they're saying. And I said to him, what are you doing? He said, I'm just aware that there's something, a conversation going on at a distance. I said, well, where are you? He said, well, I'm close by, but I'm not in the room with you. But he said, this went on for a couple of weeks. And it was intriguing, it was fascinating. And then one day, things changed. And he went into trance. And Chang P introduced himself, said good evening. And we developed a rapport and a courtesy. I was beginning to learn the Chinese courtesy, the greeting. And he said to me, I think the time has come. I'd like to introduce you to somebody else that would like to speak with you. So I said, fine. I'd learned to trust this Chinaman, and I knew nothing bad was going to happen. He said, good. And he left. And the young man sitting in front of me, all the time the spirit was speaking to me, he was upright, his eyes were open. Cheng Pei left and he collapsed into his trance. After a few moments, he looked up, his head came up, and he opened his eyes. And when he opened his eyes, it was different. This was not Cheng Pei. Again, the body and face was the body and the face of the young man. But the spirit that presented through him, through the eyes, was completely different. It was no longer chamber. And I could see that there was a difference. So I said, to whom do I have the pleasure of addressing? I would have said in my ignorant, uneducated English, who the hell are you? But I'd learned from Chang Pei. He had guided me in the etiquette. To whom do I have the honour of addressing? And he said, my name is Lao Tzu. And I said, you are most welcome. Without having ever heard the name before, without having any idea who or what he was, he was a complete stranger. But I made him welcome. And from then, it was he that engaged me in dialogue. And we would talk until 2, 3, 4 o'clock in the morning with this young man sitting there with his own mind dissociated down the end of the long corridor. And he didn't understand what was being said. So that was my introduction to Lao Tzu. And he gave me more insights, more direction, as to how to develop a book and how to approach each chapter and so on. So he was mine, and it was just like having a teacher sitting in front of you. But I still didn't realise the significance of what was happening. I was completely in the dark. And one day in a lecture, I was attending this college to get this access qualification to go to university. And one day, a lecturer passed around and distributed a handout. And on it was a poetic quotation with the name Lao Tzu underneath it. So I said to the lecturer, I said, oh, this thing you passed out, you've got a quote here from Lao Tzu. And she said, yes. I said, that's interesting. Who's Lao Tzu? And she didn't know. A lecturer passing something out with a quotation, and she didn't know who the quote. But there was one chap in the class, a fellow student, he said, yes, Lao Tzu, I know him. I've got a book of his at home, I'll bring it in. And the next day, he presented me with a copy of the Tao of Chi. And I looked at it, and I looked at the back cover, and I read, this is the second most widely translated text, second in the world to the Bible. I thought, well, that's an important piece of work, isn't it? And the author's Lao Tzu. It wouldn't quite compute, couldn't completely make sense of all this. So when I went home, I called this young man round, invited him round for dinner, as I often did, and I said to him, who's Lao Tzu? And he said, isn't he the Chinaman you talked to when I was in France? Exact word. I said, yes. But who is he? What is he? He said, I don't know. I don't know what you're talking about. And I showed him the book. And he went, he did what I did. Jaw dropped open and he had to sit down. And he went, you can't be serious. I said, well, let's find out. So he went into trance for me. He went into trance, and he didn't need my help doing it after all this time practicing. Just going to go into trance, and just got up a medium to know that. He went into trance. And after a few moments, his head came up, his eyes opened, and he looked at me, and there was a smile. And I said, why didn't you tell me who you are? And he smiled and he said, because his hands. He said, because isn't it so much more fun to find things out for yourself? And that was my introduction to Lao Tzu, and that's where the book came from. I had to change the name of it to The Tao. When I realised, and it took, I'm not an intellectual. I'm not a highly educated. I'm a simple man. I'm just a truck driver that learned to make my way up through the distribution industry. So I'm not an intellectual. So it took a little while for it all to sink in, especially as all this information is of a philosophical and a spiritual nature. So I'm like a child in kindergarten. I've got to start learning right from lesson one. And that's where it really started. So the principles that are contained in what I now call The Tao of Natural Cycles was written by a completely naive, academic, empty vessel. And some would argue that's its value, because what it teaches us, what it helps me to understand, is that you don't have to be clever as it's defined by other people. You don't have to have a high IQ. You don't have to have lots of academic qualifications to have knowledge and wisdom. Amongst the first questions that I asked when that prompted this energy to come through and produce this book was, who can we trust? Why are these things happening to me? Can we trust our parents, our teachers, our politicians, government, our religious leaders? Who's going to teach us the truth? And it took the spirit of Lao Tzu to give me the answer. So, if you like, Lao Tzu was the one that opened the door to the university where I was going to learn these spiritual truths. And the actual universities I went to, they were just stepping stones. They weren't real learning. They were academics playing at being academics. They were being paid to teach. And they were being, and students had to conform to what they were being taught. And I had a big problem with this. I kept getting my wrist slapped by my supervisor saying, you've got to conform, you've got to write this way, you've got to tell it. And she said, when you've got your doctorate, when it's all done, then you can go away and do what you do best. But while you're here doing this, you've got to conform. So when I stand back and look at that now, and I look at society, and I look at politics, and I look at the economics, look around me, and I can see so much more clearly where people are being misled and misguided and indoctrinated and led down blind alleys. And unfortunately, I could sit here and talk about what's in the book all night, because for me, it gives me a formula, if you like. Yes, it's a formula for the creation and the maintenance and the evolution of the universe and everything in it. Now, for an uneducated man to say something like that is an absurdity, isn't it? Isn't it?
No.
To me, it's not now. But it's taken me 20 years to get the evidence, because when I first wrote it down, it was an absurdity. But where did this come from? How does this make sense? But what I'd written was an explanation of how happiness and sadness are part of the flux of everyday life. And I looked at the cycles of history, the cycles of economics. I'll tell you what, I'll leave you to a little secret. Every morning at 6:30, my alarm goes off and I get up and I switch on my laptop and I look at my computer and I'm looking at what the euro is doing in relation to the US dollar, the Australian dollar. Japanese yen. It's all there on the screen. Right? And I tell you what happens. Certain days of the week, at certain times, according to certain economic conditions, synchronicity steps in, the pattern forms, and I go, yes. I've learned to do what the bankers do. Now, where did I get that from? Because I wrote a chapter on economic cycles. Where did that information come from? University of Michigan, Lao Tzu. Everything moves in cycles. The economic cycle that caused the collapse of my business in 1991 it's part of a recurring cycle. Happens every 8 years. The next one's going to come next year. Another collapse. We've had a precursor for it with the panic on the Chinese stock market a couple of weeks ago. Right? It's a precursor. Because these cycles are part of a universal pattern, the universal flux. And in the economic markets, the rise and fall of share prices and foreign exchange markets, they are driven by human beings. And the two primary emotions that drive the economic markets, the foreign exchange markets, can anybody guess what they are? Two primary emotions that drive the market.
Greed and fear.
Fear.
Greed and fear. Spot on. Spot on. Greed and fear. So, you can sit in front of a screen and watch a graphic representation of what's going on globally, and you can see what's in control. Greed or fear. And you can trade whichever way the market goes, if you're in tune with it. You can go with the fear and you can sell. You can go with the greed and you can buy. And this is what the big banks are doing. Okay. So the next time the stock market reaches a sharp peak, the sharper the peak, the bigger the fall. And they know it, and they're ready for it. So when it reaches its peak, they sell and take their profits. That causes jitters. Next thing they do is sell short and they catch the whole drop and buy again when it hits the bottom. You and me don't matter to them. No. We're just the fodder that pays the bill when they get bailed out for declaring themselves bankrupt. They're not bankrupt at all. They're just milking the system. Now where did it... I'm not an economist, I'm not a banker. But I listen to ancient wisdom and I see the patterns work in front of my eyes. There's the evidence. So when I sit here and say to you or anyone else, as I've said in the past, I've had the spirit of Lao Tzu talk to me, right? And they say to me, you're an idiot, right? Or don't respond at all. I've had to go and get the evidence to support what was given to me. And the evidence is there. And what I've discovered are truths that are hidden from the rest of us. So I could talk about this all day and all night. Mm-hmm. But what I've written in the book, and again, from a naive mind, I've written about the pattern of cycles that affect the individual. The cycles of personal development as we grow from birth through the different stages of life, the rise and falls as we go through trials and tribulations, and the crises that we have to overcome in order to develop as human beings. That's the psychology part of it. Then we look at the relationships with those that are closest to us, our parents, loved ones, siblings, and the dynamics, the rise and fall in the flux in emotional relationships. True love never runs smooth, we know that. It's all full of ups and downs, and it's a rocky road. But there's a pattern to it, and it has a time cycle. That's explained. Then we've got workplace relationships with colleagues, stepping into a new working environment and learning how to deal with it. So I've done a chapter on the individual cycle, done a chapter on the relationship cycle, that's emotion, done a chapter on the learning cycle, that's the intellect, done a chapter on the physical body and how it develops. I've done a chapter on interrelationships in the workplace, which leads us on to business, providing a service to the community as an entrepreneur, that leads us on to the larger economic picture. And we progress from the individual through society. And what I say in the introduction to the book is that what we have to do, first of all, was to look at the human being through the eyes of the zoologist first, because the human being is an animal of planet Earth, like any other living thing. It has innate zoological drives for reproduction and survival. That's what drives the human animal. So when you look at human behavior, rather than the theories of the psychiatrist or Freud or the psychologist, look at him through the eyes of Desmond Morris first. Desmond Morris was a great inspiration to my thinking when he looked at the human animal. And when you look at nature programs, David Attenborough on the television newspapers in modern times, it's all there. It's all there, the way animals interact with each other and treat their offspring and so on. We're no different. The emotions are the same. The behaviours are the same. What's different is the environment. And that takes us, now we move away from that, into the realm of the anthropologist that studies society and culture. And what makes the differences in the different major religions, whether it be Hindu, Muslim, Christian, Judaism, North American Indian, Guatemalan, shamanism, whatever, right? Look at them, and instead of what the academics do, identify the differences and study the differences, look at the common threads. Look at what binds them all together. What is the sameness about them all? I'll tell you what the differences are. The differences are language and culture. And those are the only differences. The underlying threads of all the world religions are the same. The golden rule, treat others as you would be treated yourself. It's simple. So what makes religions different are the culture that they're interpreted in. Strip away the culture, get to the fundamentals, get to the fundamental teachings, and they're all the same. So then we look at how cultures have evolved through history. And taking the principle of and the rise and fall of the cycle, if you take yin and yang, right, as a model for the evolution of history, everything moves in cycles. And what I've observed from my understanding of history is that as time has progressed, as we've marched from ancient history through the Middle Ages into the modern times, the rate of change has accelerated. If you go back to Sumerian times or Egyptian times or ancient Greece, right, the day-to-day events of ordinary people were the same from day to day. Nothing really changed. Nothing catastrophic happened. Unless wars were a way of life. Everybody was at war. But the technology, I'm talking about the technology and the culture that's driven by technology, didn't change. I mean, we had the Bronze Age, the Iron Age, these were eons of time when nothing really changed very much, until you get someone like Alexander the great Greek thief come along and want to destroy everything that has taken millennia to build up. And you've got a catastrophe. So when you look at world history and you can see the catastrophes that happened, they were essentially human initiated, human catastrophes brought about by human beings. And as time has marched on, the technology has got more advanced and changes are faster. So if I can put this into context with the rise and fall of empires, the rise and fall of the Greek, the Egyptian, the Roman, and so on throughout history, getting to more modern times, you've got Russian communism, the Third Reich, you've got Chinese communism, these are all empires, right? British Empire. How long did the British Empire last? Lasted 350 years, right? How long did the Third Reich last? 30 years, less than that. So what we see from what I call the shape of history is that as time has marched on, the length of time that it's taken for an empire to be built and lost, or for a civilization to emerge and decline, has become shorter and shorter and shorter and shorter. And where we are now, in the space age, the technological age, when did that age begin? You could argue with the end of the Second World War, with the advent of rockets and nuclear bombs, right? Within our lifetimes. So historical events have happened within living memory that outstrip the events that happened eons ago that took hundreds and thousands of years to change. So what does that tell us about technology, change, what's happening to the planet, where we're going, evolution? What does it tell us about evolution? What do the financial markets tell us? There's a pattern. It's a bit scary, actually. It's a bit scary. Anyway, that's what the book was about, and it was Lao Tzu who gave it to me. Thank you very much, Lao Tzu. Estimated 500 years BC.
Right. Why did he choose you?
Why did he choose?
Well, did he say why he chose you?
I wouldn't say he chose me. I suppose he volunteered to answer my questions. But I'm not here. I'm not unique. Lao Tzu I didn't realise it at the time, that he was my first experience of spirit possession. It was the spirit of someone who lived before and came and took possession of someone living and used that person's body to speak to me. And that's my first experience of that. Other people would call it something else. Spiritualists would call it trance mediumship, for example. And the shaman would call it something else. But it's my first experience of a living person being used by and occupied and possessed by the spirit of someone who lived before. And ultimately that led to my writing the science of spirit possession, because there is scientific evidence to support it. But as far as the individual is concerned, I'm not the only person that's been influenced by Lao Tzu. I've been in communication with mediums in North America that regularly commune with him and other historical figures. He's a far more highly educated man than I am, and I've been interested in reading his book because he's made a far better job of it than I could ever do, because mine is written from the naivety of someone who's uneducated. But Wayne Dyer has used... Whether Wayne Dyer actually spoke on a one-to-one basis with Lao Tzu, I don't know. He may just be influenced by his work. But there are other people that have spoken with Lao Tzu as a spirit entity.
interesting.
Any other questions?
On your life crush, why did you choose Greece?
I've been taken there before, I've been on holiday there before. It's actually an interesting question, that, because it makes me think about, why I went there. And I've traced the origins of that through. When I was an organiser of transport conferences and exhibitions, I was on a conference in Naples, Italy, 1987, with the Road Transport Association. And when I was there, I was a single man, I met a lady who was on holiday. She was from Germany, her name was Renata. And we became friendly. And Renata had a daughter who'd gone on holiday to Crete and married a local. She asked me to accompany her to visit her daughter who was living in Crete, and that's how I came to be introduced to Crete. But coincidentally, or rather synchronistically, it was Renata, the German lady, that gave me that original book, the King James Bible. So there was significant. She was a Mormon. So that's part of the creed. Does that help?
Yeah,
sure. See how things come together? You think it's coincidental, but it's not coincidence, it's synchronicity. Mm-hmm. Things come together because they are.
What was your reason for going to Crete when your life kind of imploded?
That's why, because my life imploded.
You need to just get some distance.
I bought a white van, a guitar, and a tent. And I went. I called in to see Renata on the way, and that's when she gave me the Bible.
Wow.
Yeah.
So how old were you when that happened? Your implosion?
How old was I? About 40, wasn't it?
Question.
Terry, can I just tell the group, Lao Tzu was the disciple of Confucius,
yeah,
more elderly Chinese philosopher. So that's where the pattern fits. Mm. Most people have heard of Confucius.
Yeah. I'm not sure about the accuracy of what you just said.
All right, I'll take it back.
Because Lao Tzu predates Confucius.
Right.
And it's written that Lao Tzu was a contemporary. And where the two philosophies are closely connected from around about the same period, they're divergent. And I've heard it said and seen written that Confucius developed his philosophy because he didn't really understand Lao Tzu. Because to be able to understand Lao Tzu, you've got to be more focused on the natural world and the nature rather than governance. And Confucius was more, if you look to put it in Renaissance terms, more Machiavellian than Lao Tzu was.
Because it was Confucius who was reputed to have said, don't do to others what you wouldn't want done to yourself, which follows through most cultures.
But yes,
virtually every philosopher throughout history has said that in different terms.
That's right, yes, I agree. But these are academic debates, we don't want that, do we? Academic debates.
You can trace the philosophy of life through all cultures, and it doesn't matter whether they're Native American Indians or ancient Egyptians or Indians or whatever, ancient Greece. It's the same philosophy. if it's the truth, it must be the same. It's just said to different cultures in slightly different ways so that they can understand it, but it's the same truth. And we were talking about this earlier, right?
Yes. And
what is truth?
Yes, and this is what Lao Tzu gave me, the thought that came to my mind, and I wrote it down, and it's in the book, is the truth is universal, constant, and eternal. If another person sees things differently to you, it's because they're looking at it from a different perspective. It's not truth that changes, it's the viewpoint, it's the perspective you take on it. I gave a lecture on this at Baker University. I was trying to explain to students and academics what my approach to scientific investigation was. And I used this model, and I quoted the Tao Te Ching. The one created the two, the two created the three. And I demonstrated how it works, where the one is truth, and that's unchanging, evolving, eternal, and unchanging. And then you've got the arcs, the positive and the negative arcs. It's the two and the three. And that creates everything, because then you get expansion and evolution. And wherever you are on the arc, if you're going through a bad experience and you're in a negative energy position, you will see the world differently to the person who's on high. And it's that simple. You can be looking at the same thing, but describe it differently. And that's what great religions do. It depends on the language and the culture as to how those great truths were interpreted and misinterpreted. So I'm just going to finish off now by saying, here sits a naive child of the universe, and I was given this huge ancient wisdom for me to understand and accommodate. And in order for me to accommodate it, I've had to go through a long, long process of expanding my own consciousness. And it's an eternal process. And I'm still a child of the universe. I still don't know. And that's when I'm going to stop.